They asked me to go over hemodynamics and pressors. It's really important, as you know. I mean, if you're not giving the patient a blood pressure and delivering oxygen, well, we've got problems. So I'm gonna try to stay superficial. I apologize if it gets a little too detailed or too superficial, because y'all do this every day as well. Stop me at any point. Let's have informal discussions. Somebody just say, wait, I'm not real sure what you're saying, etc. You're not gonna mess up my flow with that. I had a nurse tell me that it's kind of hard to learn in a lecture or reading a textbook. It's just much easier to do it. And to some point, I completely agree with that. But if you don't walk into the patient's room with a ton of knowledge in your head, you're already behind. You have to understand what's going on, and then you can kind of anticipate what you're going to change, what the physician's orders are going to be, why they're doing it, and you just comprehend it much, much better. And with that, you can Google any of these, and it's going to pull up Wikipedia or whatever. I believe about half of that. So look at evidence-based medicine. That's where we are in medicine. That's the facts. Supported by studies. It's not somebody's opinion. It's not, well, this one time I had a patient and this happened to it. Yeah, let's look at some of the bigger studies and some of the evidence-based stuff. That being said, when you give a lecture, some of this will be a little shaded more towards my opinion. If a different physician was sitting up here, you might get a little bit different response to some of this. So just an example of how, when you know this stuff really well, how it's just gonna click really easily with you, and it's just gonna make sense without you thinking about all the formulas, all the receptors, etc. But if you walked in and saw a patient in the ICU laying there, and they've got a blood pressure of 70 over 30 and a heart rate of 30, I think everybody's pretty much got it figured out. They're too bradycardic. Their cardiac output's not enough. I don't even know if you're making it that far. Your mind subconsciously is, but you realize we've got to speed up the heart rate, make this blood pressure better. That's the way I want every number on this machine or everything we talk about to just click just like that. It just makes sense. So let's start talking about the pressors, the vasoactive drugs, and a few of the receptors that they work on. We're gonna keep it really basic on the receptors. Yes, there's alpha 1, there's alpha 2, there's beta 1, there's beta 2. Let's just make it simpler. There's alpha and there's beta. With none of these pressors are we really talking about alpha 2 at all. It's just alpha 1. So alpha, vasoconstriction, beta, make the heart squeeze harder and faster. And just keep it that simple. There are a few exceptions on some of these drugs that I'll mention beta 2, which causes some vasodilation. But otherwise, just think alpha and beta. Keep it simple. With these drugs, I was told a long time ago, none of them are all good. They can really help the patient, save the patient, but they can really hurt a patient too. They all have some really bad side effects that can be made worse if you're not using them in the correct situation. So the first one that a lot of y'all, especially in the CVICU, are familiar with is dopamine. I've been here 7 years, and I'd never used that drug in training in the medical ICU and stuff like that. Yes, we had, but not in the hearts themselves. And when I came here, they used it a lot. It was our basic drug. And I found out it works, and it's effective. But, and this is an opinion, it's better for what we call kind of some of the healthier hearts. If they just need a little bit of support or speed their heart rate up just a little bit, it works for that. It used to be thought that it was renal protective. That's been out for 15 years. It's not renal protective. It does increase some blood flow to the kidneys, and it will make the patient make more urine. but it does not protect them from renal insufficiency or failure or anything like that. What it does do is it can cause some arrhythmias. All of these beta drugs can, but that one really can. It's an older drug. It's starting to fall out of favor. So you're gonna probably see us, at least with the heart, using that one less and less. It's what I call a shotgun drug. It works on all receptors, predominantly on a certain one depending on the dose. So from say 2 to 4 mics per kilo per minute, you're working on the dopamine receptors. More blood flow to the kidney, more urine output. After that, 5 to 10 range, the moderate range, you're working mainly on beta, making the heart squeeze harder, squeeze faster. That is mostly why we're using that drug. That's the range we're looking for in that drug. In my head, that is a beta drug. If you get higher than 10, 10 to 20, rarely will you see us go over 20, you're working more on the alpha receptors, vasoconstriction. But there are much better drugs to work on alpha. So usually that moderate range is what you're gonna see with that drug to use for beta, make the heart squeeze harder, let's get more cardiac output, speed up the heart rate a little bit. Next in the line, dobutamine. It's rarely used around here, but it is a great drug. If you want to be a purist and have one drug for beta and one drug for alpha, this is a great drug because it is solely beta. It does not work on alpha, and in fact, this is one of those exceptions I was telling you about. It works on beta 1 and beta 2. The beta 2 part is going to cause a little bit of vasodilation. Reduce the afterload, make it easier for the heart to pump out. It's not working against such an afterload, such a resistance, but it's gonna make the heart squeeze stronger and faster. When you're using that drug, you need an alpha drug hanging and ready to counteract its vasodilation, especially if the patient is already hypotensive. Epi. That one's familiar to most people. You're gonna see it a lot, especially in the CVICU. It's dosing, here they use nanos per kilo per minute. If you read in a lot of studies and textbooks, you'll see mics per kilo per minute. It's just simply moving the decimal point. It's still the same dose. But because we use nanos here, that's kind of what I'll talk about. It's also a little bit of a shotgun drug, but it's a 12 gauge. I mean, it is a strong, strong drug. Kind of in the 10 to 50 nano range, you're getting more beta. So lower dose, more beta. When you get above 50, you're starting to predominantly work on alpha. You will see us go up to about 200 on this drug, but that's someone who's really, really sick. Typically, you're not gonna get much over 100 nanos on that drug, unless your hand is forced to do it. But again, it's very powerful. It's gonna make the heart squeeze much harder. It's gonna improve all your numbers across the board, cardiac output, SVR, etc. But it's a great drug as well. And then last in kind of the beta category is a drug you probably don't see a whole lot. We probably should use it just a little bit more, but it's called milrinone. It can be thought of in the beta category, but its mechanism is much different. It doesn't work on beta, but again, to simplify it, just think of it as a beta drug. It's a phosphodiesterase inhibitor. We're not gonna get into the mechanism of how that works or whatever, but what it does, it causes the heart to squeeze stronger. Maybe a little bit of an increase in heart rate, but more than anything, it's just gonna cause the heart to squeeze stronger. Again, it will cause some vasodilation. So with milrinone, you need to have an alpha drug, which we're about to get to, in line and ready, especially if the patient's hypotensive. What it is really good for is it causes vasodilation of the pulmonary arteries. If a patient has pulmonary hypertension and the right heart is just struggling to push against that much pressure, because remember, the right heart is very thin muscle, very weak compared to the left side. And that's kind of a, I'm gonna go out in left field for just a second. Start thinking in your really sick patients about the left heart and the right heart. They're two totally separate things. That takes a little bit longer because normally you just think about the patient's heart, but they're battling two separate issues, with the right heart being weak, and if the blood pressure's high in the lungs, it's gonna fail pretty quickly. Milrinone's a great, great drug for that. Again, you're not gonna see it a whole lot, but on special patients, you will. So that was beta. Dopamine, dobutamine, epi, and milrinone. Those are the ones you can think about. Let's get more cardiac output, make the heart squeeze stronger, squeeze faster. Now on to alpha. You'll probably see more of these used than the beta drugs, especially on patients that are not nearly as sick. They're just a little hypotensive, need a little bit of vasoconstriction, need a little bit better blood pressure. The most common one that we use is phenylephrine, which is neosinephrine. It is strictly alpha. It causes vasoconstriction on both sides, the artery and the vein. You can think of the venous side as just a big reservoir full of blood. You vasoconstrict it, you're sending all that blood back to the heart. You're getting more preload to the heart. But also it's working on the arterial side. Vasoconstriction raises the SVR, so your blood pressure is gonna go up. With that drug, especially if you're at high doses, you may see a little bit of reflex bradycardia. The receptors in the aorta, they squeeze down, they see a higher blood pressure, they tell the heart, hey, let's scale back just a little bit, don't pump as hard and as fast. So you may see just a little bit of reflex bradycardia with that. It shouldn't be an issue unless you're bolusing it, which would rarely occur. That's the one of the weaker alphas we have that we use every day. It doesn't matter if anyone in this room, as me being an anesthesiologist, if you're healthy and you're getting your gallbladder out, I'm gonna have some neo sitting back there ready. Because when I give you any of these sedative drugs, your blood pressure sags just a little bit, I can give you a little bit of neo. We use it every day on every case. The next one, more powerful drug, norepi, which is levofed. Some people may say, no, I've heard it has some beta as well. Yes, it does have a very small amount. But again, don't think of it like that. Just think alpha when you think of norepi. With the beta, it has just enough to prevent that reflex bradycardia that we talked about with neo. But you should just think of it as a really strong neo. It got a bad reputation. Y'all have probably heard it. Instead of levofed, leave them dead. When that drug is so powerful, when it's used inappropriately in a hypovolemic patient, and you're just using that drug to get a better blood pressure, when you didn't realize that what they really needed was volume, yes, you don't have enough volume, you're constricting the vessels down to the size of a straw, the organs are gonna suffer, the kidneys are gonna suffer first, and it will hurt the kidneys, it can kill the patient. That's how it got a bad name, but it is an excellent drug when used appropriately. Last, and this one, again, doesn't work on alpha receptors, is vasopressin. It works on vasopressin receptors, but to keep it simple, just think of it as an alpha drug. It does vasoconstriction. Again, it's very powerful. Rarely will you see it used, probably just in special cases, select patients, etc. But it is a great drug, and specifically with the hearts, anybody who's been on an ACE inhibitor, lisinopril, etc., we try to get it stopped at least a day, 2 days before, but sometimes they're just resistant to any of these alphas, and so they will come back on some low-dose vasopressin. Doesn't really mean that they're just super sick and that we've made our progression all the way to one of the most powerful medicines. We just run it at really low dose because they're prone to vasodilation by being on an ACE inhibitor. But so to sum it up, alpha is neo, norepi, and vasopressin. Think of it like that. Norepi and vasopressin, very powerful. Neo, just kind of an everyday, let's tighten them up a little bit, make a better blood pressure type of drug. Any questions on the vasoactive drugs whatsoever? Okay, now on to all the physiologic measurements, parameters, etc. Most of which you'll see up here on the Vigileo. We'll get to the actual monitor here in just a little while. But all these drugs are working on these parameters, and you're looking at them trying to optimize it for the patient. So blood pressure is MAP, mean arterial pressure, cardiac output times SVR. It's just that simple. Those are the variables that you're trying to work on to give the patient a better blood pressure. Cardiac output, normal, and I know you're not going to remember all these formulas, especially when you're not sitting, looking at it, thinking about it all by yourself. That's okay. But cardiac output is 4 to 8 liters a minute. That's kind of normal. It really depends on the patient's size, but that's just a normal range. All it is stroke volume, how much the ventricle is squeezing out, times the heart rate. That gives you cardiac output. The two things that are going to affect that is intravascular volume and beta. If they're hypovolemic, the heart can squeeze as hard and as fast as it wants. It has nothing to squeeze out or less than adequate to squeeze out. Cardiac output's gonna be lower. So volume's gonna correct that. Beta, if their heart's weak, etc., we make it squeeze harder, we make it squeeze faster, cardiac output's gonna go up. Cardiac index is the exact same thing as cardiac output. It is just related to the patient's size. So it's just cardiac output divided by their body surface area. It automatically calculates that on most any monitor we have. And that way we can relate it to any patient's size. If we ask what the cardiac index is, everybody's kind of on the same page with that. Normal is 2.5 to 4. Usually our cutoff on that one is anything less than about 2.2 is probably not adequate. You have to look at other things, how well the patient's doing, but that starts to raise some eyebrows at 2.2. Stroke volume, it's pretty simple. You're getting pretty deep if you're looking at this or any other monitor going, okay, exactly what is my stroke volume on this patient? And we have some really great technology now, but I don't know if it's really that great to actually measure how much blood came out of that heart each time it squeezed. But just know that it's there. 50 to 100 mLs is kind of a normal stroke volume. Again, what works on that? Beta and volume. One that's really, really important that's helped us out with volume management very, very much is, and you'll see it on this machine, it's called stroke volume variation, SVV. You'll also see it as A-line variation, etc., in different studies. That one has become really important, really popular. A lot of studies are coming out about it because, as you know, volume and how much to give a patient is very controversial. This has helped us with our management probably more than anything in quite some time, understanding this. The problem is, which in your sickest patients, it works perfectly, but they have to be on positive pressure ventilation, on a ventilator, at least 6 mLs per kilo. So a decent tidal volume, a decent positive pressure going in their chest, and they have to be in normal sinus rhythm. If they're in AFib, obviously each time the heart squeezes, because it's beat, beat, pause, then a beat. After that pause, they're gonna eject more because they had more time for blood to fill. So the A-line's gonna go up and down. It's gonna measure that. Doesn't work in that. So on a ventilator, normal sinus rhythm, that is when that is very, very useful. What the number we're looking for is below 13%. If you've got this, it calculates it for you. Right here, it's saying 30. That would indicate the patient may possibly be hypovolemic, need some volume. It's not an absolute, but it just gives you a really good indicator. As far as you don't have that machine, you walk into a room, and I do this a lot without even looking at it, and a patient's on a ventilator, they're a little bit hypotensive, just look up at the screen at the arterial line, and you can time it pretty perfect. But if you're looking at the top of the A-line where it peaks, and every time the vent fires, it just kind of sags down. After a few seconds, it just comes back up. It's just a sigmoid pattern on the screen, and it correlates with every time the ventilator delivers its breath and the positive pressure to the chest, you just see the A-line sag a little bit. Well, your eye's not good enough to know, okay, from this peak, the lowest to the highest, that's about 13%. But once you start seeing it on the monitor that is significant, it's at least 13%. And it's an indication the patient may be dry, they may need some volume. Lastly, SVR, systemic vascular resistance, is just telling us how tight are the arteries constricted down. Are they vasodilated and that's the reason for their hypotension? Do we need to just add a little bit of tone, squeeze them down a little bit, get their blood pressure up? Normal's 800 to 1200, you can just kind of average that out in your mind and think 1000, that's kind of the normal midpoint. SVR is completely alpha. When you see SVR, I just want you to think alpha. If it's too low and the patient's hypotensive, alpha is your drug, most situations. We touched a little bit on the volume, and it is very controversial. You can read for the next 2 weeks on it and still come out scratching your head, because one great study is going to say this, the next great study with thousands of patients is going to say something a little bit different. It's been that way for years. Every physician will be just a little bit different on it. The main thing is you just don't want them too dry to not get enough blood flow to the organs, especially the kidneys. And then you don't want them volume overloaded so that it starts backing up into their lungs, affecting that. But when you think volume, obviously go to the old standby, urine output, are they making enough? Even if they're not, it doesn't mean that it's just a volume thing. They may not have enough cardiac output. They may be volume overloaded. They just don't have enough cardiac output or blood pressure for the kidneys to see to make urine. But when they're not making urine and everything else is doing okay parameter-wise, think volume. And then more than anything, go back to that arterial line variation, or with this machine, the stroke volume variation. They're basically the same idea. You can also look at, when they're on a ventilator, your ventilator peak pressures to see, are we volume overloading the patient? So when I walk into a room and I say, you know, what are the peak pressures? And the respiratory therapist will read it off. You just kind of make a mental note of that. I know it's all charted now and you can go back and look. But 3 hours from now, if a lot of things have changed and you look at that and it's gone up tremendously. You know, it was, peak pressures were 25, now they're 45. and you've given the patient a whole lot of volume in the meantime, there's probably the reason right there. So you have to look at those peak pressures to kind of know when to say, all right, maybe we're getting a little bit too much volume on this patient. It's backing up into their lungs, providing more resistance to the breath that we're giving to the patient. So you kind of have to keep that one in the back of your head, especially, you know, when you call the physician and you're telling them about the patient. I know your own opinion comes into it, and you can kind of steer them to what you're really wanting, what order or what you're getting at. We all know that. So knowing that the peak pressures on the ventilator are going up is a great piece of information to kind of throw in there, to kind of say, hey, we might be getting a little bit too much volume on board here. Another controversial subject under volume, albumin versus crystalloid. Crystalloid's been around for a really long time. In some situations, albumin does look like it may be a little bit superior. But it seems like, especially in the CVICU after hearts, and there is some literature out there that's saying post-heart albumin does have some advantages. But it seems like we will see, you know, how much volume did the patient get? And somebody will say, oh, I think we've given, you know, 5 bottles of albumin. Number one, albumin's a little bit pricey. If it's far superior, then who cares? If you're saving the patient, price is not going to be factored in there. But after a couple of albumins, my opinion, and again, I said some of the things in here will be opinions, there's nothing wrong with mixing some crystalloid in there. It's been used for a really long time, and if you still need volume, you know, alternate. A little bit of albumin, next one some crystalloid, etc. So you will see them kind of mixed in to provide the patient with some volume, and then obviously blood products as well. Getting a little bit deeper, and sometimes you may say, you know, I have a pretty good grasp on the baseline of all this, but they still sometimes kind of surprise me, and I thought we were going to give volume and thought the patient needed it based off everything I've read and learned, et cetera, and we didn't. Well, it goes just a little bit deeper when you're looking at the heart, and there's a thing called the Frank-Starling curve. We're not going to get into it. It's graphs. It's complicated. If you have 10 minutes sometime, look at it. It's very interesting, but they did all these experiments and kind of figured out where the heart is normally with volume and how well it squeezes. Give it less volume, what happens? Give it more volume, what happens? So there is a perfect balance point, as everybody's already probably assumed. But also, and this is a little bit controversial as well, you can overload a ventricle. Left side, much harder to do because it's thick, it's strong, it's not just going to stretch like a balloon. The right side, you can overload. So if you get too much volume into it and it's just too ballooned out, it starts to not work well. The myofibrils are supposed to line up exactly perfect, this and that, to make for the best squeeze. And if you just stretch them out too much, it's just not going to work well. That being said, kind of the one thing you need to take from that Frank-Starling curve is a normal heart is preload sensitive. Assuming everybody in here doesn't have any major heart defects or anything, we need the preload, the volume coming back to the heart. We're pretty sensitive to that. We get dehydrated, we're going to start feeling lightheaded, may pass out, etc. A failing heart, a sick heart, an acidotic heart, it's afterload sensitive. It's weak, it's not doing so well. You increase the resistance it has to push against, and that's when it's just going to kind of call it quits. Especially the right side being more sensitive to that than anything. And that's kind of where some of your milrinone and stuff like that comes in. Nitric oxide, you're trying to reduce the blood pressure in the pulmonary artery so the right heart doesn't have to work so well. or it doesn't have to work so hard. All right, on to the monitors. Like I say, the technology has come a long way, and this is why I love critical care so much. Number one, the patient's sick and they need you, and they need you making the right decisions, you know, to save their life, to help them out. But we have every monitor we could want in the ICU. You go see somebody up on 6 North, and sometimes you're just kind of guessing, you know, you're palpating here, listening with stethoscope. I'm not really sure why they're hypotensive and dizzy. I don't know. In the ICU, if they have all these monitors and lines, all those excuses are out. You get to look at them. You get to formulate what's going on. You have every advantage if the tools are used correctly. So let's just start off with an arterial line. Most commonly in the radial artery or the femoral, it really doesn't matter there. But why do you need an arterial line? Hemodynamic monitoring. Patient's a little unstable. If they're on, this is an opinion, if they're on any of those vasoactive drugs that we talked about, especially some of the more powerful ones, if they're on levofed, and you see it all the time, I see it all the time, there's a patient on a ventilator who's getting a little sicker, so they just started some norepi to try to bring their blood pressure up, and it's not like I'm busy and I'm gonna come right back and put it in an ART line. It's they've been that way for the past day. They don't have an arterial line, suggest it. Don't worry about hurting anybody's feelings, just suggest it. The physician can say no, but they need it. It's hemodynamic monitoring. Again, it'll help you with the volume aspects, with the A-line variation, et cetera, but they need an arterial line. Also another indication, when they need multiple ABGs. So you don't have to stick and stick and stick them over and over. They're on a ventilator. They're gonna be that way for at least a day. They need an arterial line. Again, that's just an opinion. The arterial line versus the blood pressure cuff. This is a little bit of opinion. There is a pretty good amount of data out there, but blood pressure cuff, it measures the mean arterial pressure. And every manufacturer has a different formula. They won't release it to anyone. And I'm sure it's really complicated in physics and this and that that I wouldn't understand, but it calculates a systolic and diastolic. Those are not measurements, those are calculations. So in my opinion, an arterial line is actually seeing the pressure, at least the pressure in that artery. Is it different in the radial versus the femoral? Yes, in some disease states or if they're on a lot of medicines, they are. But at least that is the pressure arterial line is seeing in that artery, as long as it's functioning properly. And I pretty much trust it over a blood pressure cuff. The way you can test an arterial line is called a fast flush test. Reach, grab the pigtail, pull it back, flush it for about 2 seconds, let it go. It's gonna go up, across, and when you let it go, it should fall straight down, bounce a couple of times, and then get back to the arterial line tracing. That is considered normal. If it's dampened from, it's kinked off, especially in the wrist, they have their wrist bent, the catheter's kinked, it has a clot in it, an air bubble, somebody forgot to flush the blood completely out, and so instead of the heparinized saline, blood has more viscosity. If there's enough of that in there, even though it's not clotted, it can dampen it. So dampened arterial line, showing a lower pressure, and when you do the fast flush test, you'll see it goes up, you're holding it, and when you let off, it just kind of like a ski slope. It just slowly kind of comes down. It may drop rapidly at first, but then it has a little parabolic curve to it before it gets back to its waveform. That's a dampened arterial line, may not be accurate. Start investigating, trying to figure out why it's that way. The other thing, you'll commonly hear it called ringing. That's an incorrect term, or whipping or something like that. That refers to a PA cath. It can sit in the pulmonary artery and it's whipping around like that. Arterial line doesn't do that, but just because they use the wrong word, they still mean the same thing. Everybody's on the same page. It's called hyperresonant. And the only time that that happens, and it amazes me how this happens, but the fluid in the line going to the arterial line kind of gets on the same oscillations as the body, the same pattern. So as the systolic's going up, that fluid is kind of oscillating up in that. So it's going to give you higher pressure, higher peak, lower valley. So higher systolic, lower diastolic. You wouldn't really know that unless you did the fast flush test. When you do it, it's going to go straight up, across like normal. It's going to come straight down. Everything's normal so far, but it's going to bounce too many times. 5, 6, 8 times before it gets back to its normal arterial line. So the fast flush test, look at that, you can tell. Do I think this arterial line is accurate or not? Next is CVP. A lot of this that I'm about to say is evidence-based. This is one you can Google and pull up a lot of studies and read it, but then it does have some opinion mixed in as well. But in my opinion, it's a poor indicator of volume. That's not to say that a trend is not useful. A trend over a day when everything else has pretty much remained the same. We're on the same dose of Neo. The patient hasn't had a big MI. We haven't changed the ventilator, the PEEP, or any of that. And the CVP was 5, now it's 20. Does that mean something? Maybe. But a spot CVP, to me, it means nothing. What is my CVP right now? I have no idea. It's different than yours, and we may both be sitting perfectly where we need to be for our physiology. What affects it? Anything downstream. So let's just pretend the venous catheter is sitting right there in the superior vena cava. A mass in the right atrium could affect the CVP. The tricuspid valve being leaky and blood blowing back towards the central line affects the CVP. Right ventricle compliance, meaning is the right ventricle squeezing well? That affects it. The venous tone, like we said earlier, if you give Neo, think of the venous side as a big reservoir, blood comes rushing back to the heart. When it does that, the CVP is going to go up. So let's just assume it doubles because we just gave a big slug of Neo. Did the patient's volume status change at all in that 5 seconds? No, they still have the same intravascular volume they did before. You just tightened the venous system, blood came rushing back, CVP went up. So another example, say you go in there, or Dr. Cannon goes in there, and you know they did this on animals all the time. We get to do it in the OR, not on purpose, but when we're trying to help the patient and we see how it affects the patient. You know, it's like a little mini lab that you learn on every day. But say he went in there and tied off the right coronary artery. After a few minutes, the right ventricle is going to get very unhappy. It's not getting oxygen and blood flow. So it's going to start not working well, not squeezing well, and its compliance is going to go way down. Well, if the right ventricle is not working well, and this whole time, let's say we're not giving a drop of IV fluids, the CVP is going to start rising and rising and rising. It may double, it may triple, etc. Again, did the patient's volume status change at all? No, but some other parameters did. That's why I think that it's a poor indication of volume overall. While we're on CVP, central lines and central line replacement. If there's erythema around it or pus around it or anything like that, yeah, it's got to be replaced. I mean, that's pretty obvious. If it's a triple lumen, all three lumens are clotted off, you can't draw from it or push through it, yeah, it's got to be replaced. It's not being useful for the reason it's in there. If it's working properly, you have no concerns, and it's been in there 6 days, does it need to be replaced? I don't know, and neither does any of the evidence. What if it's been in there 8 days, 10 days, 12 days? Same answer. We don't know. There is no exact time, magic day period, when a central line's been in too long that it needs to be replaced. And here's why. There is a huge meta-analysis study that looked at thousands and thousands of patients over a whole bunch of studies. What they found is not all that surprising. On insertion of a central line is when most of your contamination happens. Yes, we use a full body drape, gown, gloves, mask. You see anybody not doing that, mention it to them nicely, but that needs to be done. But still, there's gonna be some contamination. So the majority of all the bacteria entering into the body with a central line is done on insertion. Overwhelmingly, 90 something percent, I think is what the study showed, versus it's just sitting there day after day with no one messing with it except for giving drugs through it, et cetera, wiping off the ends correctly with alcohol, stuff like that. So it's a risk benefit thing. It's been in there 8 days and the patient has a fever. This study still did not recommend replacing it. Now that's starting to get a little bit into opinion, but the risk versus benefit is if we replace it, we're risking introducing more bacteria into the body than if we left it alone. But it's controversial, and truthfully, no one knows the correct answer to that. So the way I kind of think about it, if you have three lumens, you're using two of them, one for an infusion, one for CVP. The third one's clotted off or it's not drawing good or whatever. We get calls all the time, you know, can you come check this out? We're happy to come check it out. We're happy to replace it if anybody wants us to. But if you still got two good working ones and there's no other problem, my preference is if it was my patient and I was making all the calls, I would leave it alone. You still got two good working lumens. Why risk introducing bacteria into the patient? The Vigileo, we use this a lot with our post-op hearts in the CVICU. I think the critical care guys are starting to use it a little bit more. So I think you're gonna see it more and more. It has all those parameters that we just talked about on it. It's a great machine. No one knows, it's kind of like the blood pressure cuff, no one knows the physics behind it, how it's actually getting its information. What it's doing is looking at the arterial waveform, the area under the curve, et cetera. But it comes up with these numbers compared to the gold standard, which is a PA cath. It's been shown to be very accurate. You can just at a glance, and yes, it's invasive because it's an arterial line, but it's not as invasive as a PA cath. You can get all those numbers we were talking about. You've got cardiac output up here, and you can arrange the screen however you want, but this is usually the way it comes. Cardiac output in the top left. Look at your index compared to the body size. Again, if it's less than 2.2, we might have an issue. Again, you're not gonna look at stroke volume all that much. SVR, that's the other important one, how tight they are. So cardiac output and index, think beta or volume. Those are the two things you need to be thinking there. Just imagine that label on this machine right next to that. SVR, alpha, again, 1,000 is kind of midpoint. You're just thinking alpha on that. And then the one we talked about for volume, stroke volume variation, just picture that it says volume right there. So except for the cardiac output index with volume affecting that, you can kind of think beta, alpha for SVR, volume for SVV. And that just kind of is a little simplified decision tree. You can quickly glance at it. When you call the physician to check out a patient who's not doing that well, mention some of those numbers. It'll really help. I see it all the time. Dr. Cannon's really busy doing another heart in the OR, and they're just reading this stuff out over the phone. No one ever mentions that. You know, he might get a blood pressure and a heart rate. They'll say something about urine output. But if it's a sick patient and they're on that, give us those three important numbers, output, SVR, SVV, and it'll really help make decisions. PA cath, like I say, it's the gold standard. Around here, we use it on only our sickest patients, pulmonary hypertension, right heart failure. I personally would like to put it in any heart with an ejection fraction of 25% or less. It really just helps us out, especially to know how the right heart's doing. Gives you the same numbers, cardiac output, cardiac index, SVR. What it does give you that this can't is PA pressure. Lets you know how the right heart's doing. PA pressure starts falling. Either the patient needs more volume or the right heart is starting to give up. And then it can give you a wedge pressure. A wedge pressure, you blow up the balloon, you're trying to see the preload to the left side of the heart. Anything over 20, left heart may be failing, fluid may be backing up into the lungs, which is gonna give you that higher peak pressure on the ventilator that we talked about. Lastly, mixed venous oxygen sat, it's SVO2. It's the way you will see that. You can get that from a PA cath. We also have some cool central lines that now they're just triple lumen central lines, but they also have SVO2 built into them. Hook it to a monitor and you can see that. It's really helpful, especially in some of the sicker patients. 60 to 80% on the mixed venous. The mixed venous can only come from a PA where the SVC and the IVC have already mixed together and it's in the PA. So on a central line, you'll see it as SCVO2, which is central venous oxygen sat. It's the blood coming from the head only. It's, you know, the central line's in the SVC. On that one, you want it greater than 70%. If it's not, it's a supply versus demand issue. If you know that your pulse ox, they're satting well, you've got enough oxygen, you know their hemoglobin hematocrit's fine, and their central venous oxygen sat is less than 70, you need more cardiac output. You need to get more oxygen to the organs. That's usually the answer. Whether that's beta or volume, you need more cardiac output. Also, while we're talking about that, we're starting to measure more of them, but in some of our sicker patients, maybe suggest a lactate. If you don't have the SVO2, which a lot of our patients don't, lactate's a great answer. Add that to the labs. A lactate greater than 4 means too many organs or muscles are going to anaerobic metabolism because they're not getting enough oxygen. And as it gets higher and higher, you've got bigger problems. You're just not getting enough oxygen to the organs. You need to do something to increase cardiac output. We've got TEE. You'll see us come in and use it. We use it every day in the operating room on our hearts, but you'll see it on some of your sicker patients in the ICU. We'll come in, put down a TEE probe. It's pretty self-explanatory. Instead of using all these numbers to try to calculate what's going on inside the heart in our head, we just look straight at the heart. We see what's going on. It simplifies things. It does have its own risk, esophageal perforation, you know, it's invasive, et cetera. And then the old fail-safe, urine output. A half ml per kilo per hour, you know, is our blood pressure and our volume adequate? Patients making enough urine, et cetera. That's not considering that we just gave them 40 of Lasix. You can do that, a patient's hypovolemic, they're still gonna make urine. So just kind of keep that in your head. If you tell somebody urine output, but you know you just gave them a ton of Lasix, maybe doesn't mean a whole lot right there. Lastly, a few things, and I apologize, but I'm on the heart team, so this will be directed more towards just the hearts and the CVICU. But these are just a few of the things that we've noticed kind of recently that maybe we would like to reverse a few of these trends and just tweak it a little bit. It can apply to any ICU and anybody dropping off a patient. But first, we use Presidex, dexmedetomidine, for sedation on a lot of our post-op hearts. It's a great drug, a little bit expensive, price is coming down. Reason we use it, it doesn't suppress respirations. Give somebody a whole lot of Versed fentanyl while they're on the ventilator, yeah, it's gonna suppress respiratory effort, hurt your efforts to get them extubated. Propofol, same way. Presidex does not suppress respirations. It's not as good of a sedative as those other ones that I said. You can actually tap somebody on the forehead and say, hey, they'll follow commands, whether they remember it or not, as in kind of in question, but it's very synergistic with other drugs. But you wouldn't want to be laying there paralyzed, because we have residual paralytics on board from the OR and intubated, and be aware. There's still some further discussions that need to be made with this. We found it was very individual to each nurse of how long they kept it on. So we're going to have to come up with a plan of what we kind of recommend. But I don't recommend turning it off as soon as we arrive, because we usually don't turn it on until after we come off pump. So the drip's been running for about an hour before we arrive, and then it's being turned off. We really didn't get any use out of that drip at all. And it should not hurt your efforts to extubate. Many centers leave it going and extubate and still leave it going for a little while. We bring the patient back from the heart room with what I call a carrier. It's just LR taking all the drips and vasopressors in at a constant rate. Some of them are really concentrated. The drip may be on 2 mL an hour. It takes a while to get the whole length of the 30 centimeters, the central line, et cetera. So we just use a carrier to keep it all going at a constant rate. A lot of times we'll see that that's discontinued, maybe even in that first hour, which is a little more critical because they're a little more unstable. And then all of a sudden, for about a 10-minute period, the patient's hypotensive and no one can figure out why. It's because all those drugs quit washing in at a certain rate, and it took 10 more minutes for them to catch up. The same with the volume line. We usually have a cordless in the IJ. I'd recommend leaving it up for at least an hour. If the patient gets really unstable all of a sudden, it has a hand pump on it. Every time you squeeze it, you're giving 50 mL of volume, whether that be blood, albumin, crystalloid. It can really help you quickly. The checkout, this applies to all ICUs. We've been taking care of the patient in the OR for the last however many hours. We know what did work, what didn't work. Like I said, it's kind of like our mini lab. We got to see all the variables. We tested some Neo, we tested some Nitro to see how they acted and all. Pay attention, listen during that. You can get some really valuable stuff from us and how the patient's acting. Do they like volume, do they not? Which drug do they respond to, which do they not, et cetera. A lot of times, and I'm the same way when I bring one back from the ICU to the OR, you get so focused on this tangle and where are my lines and this and that you kind of forget that we need to get a blood pressure on the monitor, we need to get a pulse ox on the monitor. Those are the important things. We don't have to empty the Foley right now. Let's do the important stuff first. The ABGs that we're getting as soon as we get back from the heart room, in my opinion, may be a little bit too early. If we get one as soon as we roll in the room, all you measured was how fast I squeezed the AMBU bag as we were transporting. We're carrying all these IV poles, et cetera. So it may not have been the adequate tidal volume and respiratory rate. Wait till they've been on the ventilator, the settings that the doctor has, for 10 minutes. Then get your ABG, and that tells them something about their ventilator settings versus how fast I was squeezing the AMBU bag walking down the hall. Pain is very important to me, should be to everybody. A lot of these surgeries we do, whether it's a big belly procedure, a chest procedure, they're really painful. I'm a wuss. I wouldn't want to lay there and hurt like that. Some people are more tolerant than others. Not me. Give me some pain medicine. If you don't, they're not going to breathe deep, and then it's just a cascade from there. But remember, fentanyl is 100 times more potent than morphine. An easy way to remember, just drop the last digit off of fentanyl, because it's in mics, and that's how many milligrams of morphine you gave. So 100 mics of fentanyl is 10 milligrams of morphine. Dilaudid, I think they've done a very good job of educating everybody on this. It's 7 times more powerful than morphine. It's an excellent drug. Takes away a lot of the side effects that morphine has, but it's still powerful. Bicarb, we use a lot of it when they have a base deficit, etc. Just remember one thing. If there's a respiratory component to their acidosis, be very, very careful. especially if they're not on a ventilator. So somebody's laboring a little bit, they're on a non-rebreather, they have some metabolic acidosis. You give the bicarb, through the reaction in the body, that turns into CO2. So if their CO2 was already marginal, it's around 50, 55, they're laboring, you give them bicarb, you just made that worse. Because all that turned into CO2, now the patient has to figure out how to increase their respiratory rate to blow that off. So just be very, very careful with the bicarb. And then finally, I know it's cliche and everybody may roll their eyes a little bit, but if you focus on the patient first, then you're doing the right thing. If you see something that seems odd, like we said with the A-line earlier, they're on a whole lot of medicines, they don't have an A-line. Say something, do something. Y'all are captain of the ship, you're at the bedside the whole time. The physicians are in and out. They may just forget. If a patient's been on a ventilator and things are rapidly changing and they've been on a certain tidal volume and respiratory rate for a while, and that's a recent change, no one's checked an ABG, call a physician, remind them. But just realize that patient is helpless laying there without you being an advocate for them. And thank you all for coming this morning. Yeah.